This episode is brought to you by Brilliant. Click the link in the description below. Imagine traveling inside a levitating capsule within a vacuum tube while going 200 miles per hour faster than a 747, all powered by renewable energy. Could Elon Musk and the Boring Company be digging cost-efficient tunnels to lay the groundwork for a system like that? Let's explore the Hyperloop, where things stand, and the future of high-speed mass transportation. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. The world has always been looking for faster, cheaper, and more efficient methods to transport goods and people around the world. But combating climate change is amplifying that quest for a solution that's also environmentally friendly. Electric vehicles have been a promising solution for small-scale transportation with reduced carbon emissions, but when it comes to mass transportation, there's still a lot of uncertainties. An ongoing technology is Maglev, which is a train system that uses magnets to improve efficiency. It takes advantage of the lack of friction to achieve speeds up to 430 kilometers per hour, or about 267 miles per hour. To do that, Maglev uses two sets of magnets, one set to repel and push the train up above the track, and another to move the elevated train horizontally. But it does have limitations due to the aerodynamics of the train itself. Which leads me to the Hyperloop, which combines magnets, vacuum tubes, electric motors, air compression, and renewable energy to reach ultra-high speed with low carbon emissions. Hyperloop is a new technology for ground-level transportation where people could be traveling in a hovering, windowless, bullet-shaped capsule inside of a vacuum tube that travels from one city to another at speeds as high as 1,200 kilometers per hour or about 760 miles per hour. Now, this ultra-high speed is achieved through a vacuum tube to lower friction and air resistance, which is the big stumbling block for normal vehicles to achieve such high speeds. It's similar to a rocket flying through space. For some additional propulsion, enormous air compressors are installed in the capsule to redirect air to the back of it. This redirected air can be sent to air bearings, which assists in levitating the metal capsules above the surface of the tube, reducing friction even further. The redirected air also solves the problem of air pressure building in front of the vehicle that could decrease its speed. And speaking of speed, to control the speed of the capsule, linear induction motors are placed along the tube to speed it up and down to the appropriate velocity for each section of the tube. If you've ever ridden the People Mover at Walt Disney World, you've experienced this on a much, much smaller and slower scale. Although it seems like super futuristic technology, transportation vacuum tubes have a very long heritage. In 1845, Isambard Kingdom Brunel, a British engineer, proposed building a tube in the southwest of England that propelled trains at speeds of 110 kilometers per hour, or about 70 miles per hour. Now that was stunning for the time, but the project proved unfeasible due to a lack of materials. Similar in design was the vac train concept, which was presented by Robert Goddard in the early 1900s. The main difference between vac trains and hyperloops is that the vac trains have an airbag suspension, but it took almost a century before Elon Musk proposed combining various aspects of these as the Hyperloop. Now, although people have often referred to the Hyperloop as Elon Musk's invention, it's not exactly a new idea. In 1978, Rand Corporation published a paper by Robert M. Salter titled Transplanetary Subway Systems, A Burgeoning Capability. In 2013, Musk published a 58-page white paper titled Hyperloop Alpha, which set out the design of the Hyperloop. And in his paper, Musk mentions the Rand Corporation's planetary concept as inspiration for the Hyperloop, and expressed disappointment that it didn't move forward. The Planetran was imagined as a system of tubes deep underground, but the building cost was enormous, $750 billion. Elon described the Hyperloop as a cross between a Concorde, a railgun, and an air hockey table. I mean, who doesn't like air hockey? Musk claimed that the vehicle could make the 560-kilometer, 350-mile trip from Los Angeles to San Francisco in only 35 minutes for a $20 ticket. He projected a total cost of $6 billion for the infrastructure, which is a little dubious, but I'll get to that in a minute. In Elon's white paper, the air pressure inside the Hyperloop tube is about 1/6 the pressure of the atmosphere of Mars. This reduces the drag force of the air by 1,000 times compared to sea level conditions, and would be equivalent of flying at about 150,000 feet. On top of that, the train would float above the tube's surface on a set of 28 air-bearing skis, and the pod itself would generate the air cushion to keep the tube as cheap and straightforward as possible. Other Hyperloop versions employ magnetic levitation rather than air skis to sustain the passenger pods above the tracks. But since Elon's paper, there have been several notable companies trying to make it a reality, like Hyperloop Transportation Technologies, or Hyperloop TT, which launched quickly after Musk's publication in 2013. Even though they're based in the US, they've made the most progress in Eastern Europe, India, and South Korea, where feasibility studies are taking place. Its capsule can reach over 1,200 kilometers per hour, carrying anywhere from 28 to 50 passengers. The company developed a carbon fiber smart material with embedded sensors for the fuselage skin, which can send information about stability, integrity, and temperature instantaneously with no cables hooked up. And I can only assume someone at the company must have been watching a lot of Marvel movies because they called the technology vibranium. On top of that, Hyperloop TT's system integrates solar panels and other renewable energy sources to create a net energy positive system that produces more power than it consumes, which also lowers the environmental expense on such a large scale infrastructure project and should keep the operational cost down, in theory. Now, Hyperloop TT also utilizes a passive Maglev technology called Indutrack, which enables a capsule to levitate over an unpowered conductive track. In the event of a power failure, the capsule automatically slows down and settles on its wheels at low speeds. The California company Virgin Hyperloop is another company that's trying to make this a reality. They've developed technologies to ensure safety and comfort. The pod safety controller continuously monitors the onboard sensors and computer systems to ensure passenger safety, and the data is transferred through a certified protocol. They also integrate technologies to detect rapid tube depressurization, automated fire suppression, emergency egress along the tube, and a pod safety controller that continuously monitors the air inside the vehicle. Now, some of the biggest pros for Hyperloop technology are speeds up to 1,200 kilometers per hour and using renewable energy to run, as well as reducing the freight shipping times, which could help reduce shipping costs. But there are some challenges delaying its release. First, the initial cost of building a Hyperloop infrastructure is absolutely massive. Virgin Hyperloop 1 has estimated the cost to be about $25 to $27 million per mile, and not including the land costs. A study carried out by Transpod, which is another company in the Hyperloop game, they showed the breakdown of the tube construction that would make up about 38% of the total cost. In 2013, Elon Musk estimated that building a route between Los Angeles and the San Francisco Bay Area would be about $11.5 million per mile. In comparison, Hyperloop 1 estimated that a 107-mile loop around the Bay Area alone, either by tunnel or a mix of tunnel and elevated tracks, would add up to between $9 billion and $13 billion. That's a whopping $84 to $121 million per mile, just a smidge above Elon's estimate. Now, in addition, similar to high-speed rail systems, Hyperloop has inherent risks that need to be carefully engineered. Even a small earthquake or the slightest damage to a vacuum tube would cause a big disaster at high speeds, which has required a huge amount of research and development money to make it safe. Those risks haven't dissuaded the companies that are currently developing studies and testing prototypes. And since 2015, for example, SpaceX sponsors the yearly Hyperloop Pod Competition, allowing student and non-student teams to participate in the design and implementation of small-scale prototypes to test out the different characteristics of a Hyperloop system. But among of all of Musk's investments, one can be easily correlated with Hyperloop technology: the Boring Company. It goes right back to Rand Corporation's Planetran with the tubes deep underground. Elon founded it in 2016 to quickly construct safe and low-cost tunnels for transportation, utility, and freight. The loop technology proposed by the company isn't in a vacuum. Instead, the loop will carry passengers on autonomous electric vehicles traveling up to 200 to 240 kilometers per hour. While their tunnels don't currently use a vacuum inside, they've said that the Hawthorne test tunnel can support Hyperloop R&D, so it could be modified to support a Hyperloop in the future. Most interesting part, though, is that the Boring Company's loop tunnels are currently priced at around $10 million per mile. With the increased interest in all the different companies proposing their own technologies, there's inevitably going to be many different standards and operating approaches. A consortium of European and Canadian Hyperloop companies are pushing an initiative around international standardization. By developing common standards, specifications, and approaches, a committee named JTC20 will help to mitigate potential challenges when implementing these systems across Europe. Leave it to Europe to continue playing the long game here. They standardized behind one EV charging standard and are already doing the same thing with this. However, there are still big challenges to make the Hyperloop a real and viable thing, and the risks of the technology are significant. If the tube is punctured, outside air would aggressively enter the tube as it attempts to balance pressure. Also, the intense vibrations would likely structurally compromise the tubes, either causing an implosion or, worse yet, spontaneous decompression. In his white paper, Musk said that the problem with this approach is that it's incredibly hard to maintain near vacuum in a room, let alone 700 miles round trip of large tubes with dozens of station gateways and thousands of pods entering and exiting every day. From the perspective of a low carbon future, the benefits of Hyperloop are clear. Virgin Hyperloop 1 estimates worldwide flights alone produced 946 million tons of CO2 in 2017. The company estimated that if every passenger flight between 310 and 930 miles switched over to Hyperloops, running on renewables, it could decrease fossil fuel emissions by 58%. Not bad. Now, while the progress has been slow, there have been a couple of recent impressive milestones. But before I get to that, if you're attracted to the idea of learning more about magnetism, check out the Electricity and Magnetism course at Brilliant. This has been one of my favorite courses so far, and another great example of why I love having Brilliant as a sponsor. This course really helped me wrap my head around how electric and magnetic fields even work. But if you're repelled by the idea of this topic, sorry, couldn't help myself, they have over 60 courses including topics in computer science, physics, and mathematics. They teach all of the concepts through fun and interactive challenges, which helps you to understand the why of something, not just the how. It helps to develop your intuition, which is my favorite part about Brilliant, and taps into the way I learn. Go to brilliant.org/undecided to sign up for free. The first 200 people will get 20% off their annual premium membership. Thanks to Brilliant and to all of you for supporting the channel. So there have been a couple of recent impressive milestones. Virgin Hyperloop conducted the first test with two human passengers in Las Vegas, using their two-seater Pegasus prototype to test the system. The pod accelerated to 160 kilometers per hour along the test track. Jay Walder, the CEO of Virgin Hyperloop, told The Verge, "No one has done anything close to what we're talking about right now. This is a full-scale, working Hyperloop that is not just going to run in a vacuum environment, but is going to have a person in it. No one has come close to doing it." The company has raised over $400 million from private investors so far and wants to start commercial operations in 2030. And just days after Virgin Hyperloop's milestone, the Korean Railroad Research Institute, or KORAIL, announced the highest top speed ever achieved in a Hyperloop test. They hit 1,019 kilometers per hour, or about 633 miles per hour, in a scale model. South Korea is trying to launch a Hyperloop network by 2024. Will they? It's still way, way too early to tell, but I'm holding out hope that I'll get a chance to ride at 700 miles per hour inside of a capsule that's made out of the same material as Captain America's shield. I can dream. What about you? Do you want to live in a sci-fi future traveling inside of a glorified hamster tube? Jump into the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all of my patrons and to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.